Good evening, everyone, and we would like to thank you for joining with us this afternoon or this evening. It's almost evening time, and we're glad that you've been able to join with us for the preaching of the gospel. There's no sweeter and more important and relevant message for to be able to be spoken forth on the glorious gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we're glad that you've joined with us this evening. And if you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you're not born again, if you're not saved, we want you to know that you can hear a message tonight and that can result in your salvation, because we're here to speak to you about the Savior. And so I want to read with you just one verse of scripture from the book of the Acts, chapter number 4 and verse number 12. And it speaks about this salvation. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Now, the speaker is the Apostle Peter, and he says these words, Acts 4 and verse number 12, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Now, he's speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior. And again, we'll read these words. "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." And that's all that we're going to read from the scriptures, and we know that the Lord will bless the reading of his holy word. Now, as I've already mentioned, there's a subject tonight that I want to speak about. Of course, it's always the subject of the gospel message, whatever way it's preached, and that is the subject of salvation. You'll notice in these words that the Apostle Peter spoke, he speaks about salvation. He says, "Neither is there salvation in any other." And so I want to speak about this great, important, relevant subject that certainly has got to do with you and has got to do with me. It's got to do with every mortal being of Adam's race, the need of salvation. And I want to ask four questions tonight, very shortly and briefly. I want to consider the question, why do we need salvation? Why do we need salvation? And secondly, I want to think about where do we get salvation? Why do I need it? Where do we get salvation? Or how do I get salvation? And then the third question is, when should I get salvation? And the last question, a very solemn question, is, what if I don't get salvation? What will be the consequences for me as a human being if I don't get God's great salvation? It's a wonderful subject. It's marvelous to think that God has provided salvation for all mankind. That is what we love to proclaim. This isn't a message that's exclusive for those that are rich, or those that are of a certain race, or those that are of a certain social standing. God in mercy has loved all humanity, and he's provided salvation for all mankind. In fact, the Apostle Paul could say in 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 2, he could say that God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So it's God's desire that all should be saved. But the big question is, why do I need salvation? Why all the talk about the need of salvation? Well, friend, there is a big problem that you and I have, a problem that separates us from God, our Maker, and it's the problem of sin. Now, I know that that's not a popular subject. I know that it's very much out of fashion and out of date as far as the thinking of our modern generation is concerned. But sin, friend, is a very serious matter in the sight of God. It may not be a serious matter in our vision, in our modern age, and the way our thinking has developed, but it's a very, very serious matter to our Creator who has made us. As he looks at us, his creatures, he sees us defiled by sin. And he just doesn't see some of us troubled with this problem, but he sees every one of us marked by sin. The Apostle Paul, when he was dealing in depth with the subject of human sinfulness in the opening chapters of the book of Romans, he concludes in chapter number 3 by saying, he says, "There is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That is, God has set a standard, a glorious standard. And he says there is no difference as far as tribal differences are concerned or national differences are concerned. He says there is no difference, For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every one of us have failed to reach the standard that God has set because of our sin. And indwelling your nature and my nature, there's a sinful heart that produces sinful thoughts, sinful actions, and sinful words that every day that we live, we break God's law and we stand before God guilty. And God is a holy God. That is, God is a God who hates sin and must punish sin. You know, very often people say, but you know, God's a good God. He wouldn't judge me, he wouldn't punish me. But friend, the very opposite is true. One of the most solemn attributes about God is that he is good. That means he will do everything right, the right way. And if we have sinned against him and broken his laws, a good God must recompense us for our sin and judgment. And so man's greatest need is to be saved from the consequences, the power and the consequences of sin. Sin is like a master that binds us. It binds us and it controls our life, and we need delivered from this. And we also need to delivered from its eternal consequences. Because, dear friend, what makes this message so solemn and serious this afternoon is that your sin and my sin, if it's never forgiven, will bring us down to hell. Now, I know, again, that's a subject that is very much out of date in human thinking. But, you know, the Lord Jesus spoke more about hell than he did about heaven. He didn't do it in a hard way. He didn't do it in a harsh way. But the Lord Jesus warned about the damnation of hell. And it's real. It's solemn. And you and I have a soul that is going to live forever. And if our souls are not saved from our sins, our soul is going to be lost forever in hell and in the lake of fire. Now, that's why we need to preach this message. That's why you need to hear it. And maybe you're sitting in your little room today and thinking about these things, and I trust you are. I want you to stop and think about your soul and where you'll be in the great forever. Soon life will be over. Even if we live a long life, life is coming to an end. Soon we'll breathe our last. We'll go out into the great forever. But the big question is where? Now, most people think if there is a heaven, they say, we'll end up in heaven anyway. It'll be all right. But you know, friend, that's not true. The Lord Jesus spoke about a road that led to life. And he said, few there be that find it. He says, it's a narrow way. He says, it leads to life. But he says, few there be that find it. But he says, there's a broad road that leads to destruction. He says, many there be that go in thereat. So against the popular idea that everybody's going to heaven, the Lord Jesus said and taught that the few are going to heaven and the majority are going to destruction. And so, friend, very soon you're going to leave this life, and so am I. And the big question is our soul saved? Are our sins forgiven? Now, can I ask you that question? As you sit on your settee or wherever you are this afternoon, I want to ask you, is your soul saved? Are you right with God? Are you saved? Have you this salvation that we've been reading about? Neither is there salvation in any other. And Peter went on to say, whereby we must be saved. So he was stressing that this is not an optional extra. This is not something that's maybe helps to have. This is something that's absolutely vital and necessary. If you're ever going to be in heaven, you must be saved. I'm very, very thankful today that I'm saved. And I want you to know, friend, that you can be saved and know it with absolute assurance. You know, so many people tell us, you know, you cannot know why you're saved or not. You have to wait to the day of judgment, and God will put your good deeds on one side of the scales and your bad deeds on the other. No, friend, that's not taught in Scripture. In fact, the Bible says that we can't do any good. We have no good works in the sight of a holy God. It's all bad and evil. And we need salvation if we're ever going to be in heaven. So I would love you to stop and think about your eternal situation. Are you ready to die? Are you saved? Do you know your sins forgiven? So that's the reason why we need to be saved. We have a soul that's defiled by sin. It's going to live forever. And if it's not saved, it's going to be lost. It's going to be banished from God forever in hell. And the Lord Jesus spoke about hell in a very, very serious way. He spoke about the fire that never will be quenched. He spoke about hellfire. And so it's a very serious matter. It's something that should really disturb us. And I would really long that those that are listening to me tonight might realize the gravity and the seriousness of this matter of being saved and seek God's salvation. You could be saved before the end of this message. But the big question is, where do I get salvation? If I need it, where can I get it? That's the big question. It's answered in this verse. Peter says, neither is there salvation in any other. He was speaking about the Lord Jesus. He wasn't speaking about the Jewish religion or the Christian religion or any place of worship. He was speaking about a person. He says, neither is there salvation in any other. So he gives us an immediate hint from this verse that salvation is found in a person. You see, many people think that salvation is found in myself. I have to do something to be my own savior. In fact, the common denominator of all world religions is this, that I have to do something to save myself. But the gospel message tells us that we can do nothing to save ourselves, but Christ has done everything that we need for our salvation. And that's the wonderful truth of the gospel. God in his mercy has provided a savior. The scripture says that the Father sent the Son to be the savior of the world. Maybe you've heard that beautiful text in John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God sent his Son into this world to be our Savior. He came to do what we cannot do for ourselves. You know, many people think, you know, if I live a good life, if I'm sincere, if I'm religious, if I help my neighbor, that'll get me to heaven. No, my friend. I'm sorry to disappoint you. That will never get you to heaven. The Bible speaks about our good works or our righteousnesses in the book of Isaiah as filthy rags. That's us at our best. We're unclean in the sight of God. The best that we can do is not enough to save our souls from judgment. We need a savior outside of ourselves to rescue us. We're lost in our sins. We're drowning in the ocean of our iniquity, and we need someone to rescue us. No matter how we struggle or try or how sincere we might be, we cannot be our own saviors. But you know, God has sent his Son to be the savior of the world. And wonderfully, friend, the Lord Jesus, the creator of the universe, God's eternal Son, God the Son, came down from heaven and he was born in a manger and he lived in poverty and he went to a cross of shame. That's what men give him. They rejected him. The leaders of the nation of Israel rejected him. The world in general rejected him. And maybe as you're sitting there listening, friend, you have until this moment of your life, you have rejected Christ as well. You've said no to him. Well, friend, outside the wall of Jerusalem, the Lord Jesus died on a cross. And why did he die? You see, many people really even don't know the reason why Christ died. They say, oh, he was dying as a martyr for his faith. He was showing us how we should stand up for what we believe in. No, friend, listen to what the Bible says. Why did Christ die? It says, Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures. That's what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures. That's according to the ancient Old Testament scriptures. They testified that a Savior would come and die upon the cross. You say, where does it say that? Listen, friend, in Isaiah chapter 53, written 700 years before Christ even came, it tells us this, that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, but the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. You see, upon the cross, the Lord Jesus was dying as our substitute. He was bearing the judgment that your sin and mine deserve upon that cross. He was dying in our place. And you know, the hymn writer put it so beautifully, that he took the guilty sinner's place and suffered in his stead. For man, oh miracle of grace, for man the Savior bled. And the reason why you can be saved, friend, is because Christ died to save you. And you say, but that's wonderful. Yes, it is wonderful. And not only did he die to save you, friend, but he rose again from the dead. He's a living Savior. But you say, how can I make him my Savior? Well, the answer is when you receive him by faith, when you trust in him, You know, there was a man long ago asked the question, what must I do to be saved? And the answer that was given to him by two preachers was, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Now, they didn't say believe about the Lord Jesus. As you sit there today, you might believe about him. Historically, you believe the story about the Lord Jesus. But have you trusted him? Just as a drowning man would grasp a life belt to save them from going down. Have you ever trusted Christ as your Savior? You know, maybe there's a weary soul today sitting, listening to me, and you would love your sins forgiven. You would long to be saved. Friend, there's a Savior that you can trust. And if you turn to him and come to him in faith and receive him as your Savior, listen again to what the scriptures say in John chapter 1, John's Gospel chapter 1. As many as received him, to them give he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe in his name. And so you can be saved this afternoon because Christ has died for you. And if you trust him, your sins will be forgiven. Again, the promise of the gospel is in John chapter 3, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And so you can be saved. But the big question, another question is, when should you be saved? And I just very briefly answer that. Friend, you need to be saved today. Because the Bible says, behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And you know, you don't know what, or I don't know what's on tomorrow. We could be in eternity tomorrow. And you know, we could miss an opportunity of being saved. This is an urgent matter. This is the most important matter of your experience, your life. And I trust that as you sit and think about these things, that the urgency will grip you. This is not a matter to put off to tomorrow. But Christ is available for you today. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And those beautiful words, the gracious invitation of Christ. Again, he could invite, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. If you come to Christ and come today, you'll be saved. But my final question is this. What if I don't get salvation? What if I say no to Christ? What if I go through life, die on my sins? What'll happen? Will I go to heaven anyway? Some people, and I'm about to finish very shortly, some people think, you know, if you're saved and born again, you'll get through the front gates of heaven, and this is where the band will be playing for you. But if you don't get saved, well, you'll get through the back door, and it'll all work out in the end. No, friend, that's completely wrong. The Lord Jesus said on one occasion, you will die in your sins, and where I am, you cannot come. Friend, be absolutely clear today. If you die as you are, you will stand before the Lord at the great white throne. And it tells us there in the book of the Revelation chapter 20, that whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And so, friend, I trust that you'll think about salvation. Neither is there salvation in any other. Christ is the only Savior. He's your only hope. Turn to him today. For it says, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. He is the only one, but he's the available one, and he's the able one, and he's able to save you today if you will come to him. I trust, friend, that if you're not saved, that this will be the day of your salvation, that you will even now, in honesty before the Lord, acknowledge your sin and acknowledge that you're wrong and that you turn to Christ. And receive him as Lord and Savior. Trust in him. Believe in him. And the promise is, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Now, thank you very much for taking the time to listen to the word of God. And we trust that this scripture will be a blessing to you. And our great desire is that you might soon be rejoicing with us. Because God's salvation brings great joy into the breast. I'm glad that I'm saved. And I'm looking forward to being with Christ in heaven. And we long that you would join us there as well.